Hello, and welcome to today's lecture on horn antennas. In fact, for the last few lectures, we have been talking about horn antenna. Until now, we have covered E-plane sectoral horn antenna, H-plane sectoral horn antenna, and pyramidal horn antenna. So let's look into other types of horn antenna, and we'll start with the conical horn antenna. So a conical horn antenna basically uses circular waveguide, which you can see over here, and then that circular waveguide is flared. So in this particular case, we actually have, let's say, a small diameter d here for the waveguide, and then we have the diameter here dm, which is the diameter of the aperture. So we have only one dimension in this particular case. In case of pyramidal, we had dimensions a and b, whereas over here we are just increasing the diameter. So we have one less dimension to optimize. And over here then, this is the length of the horn antenna. In this particular case, face center will be only one, whereas in case of pyramidal horn antenna, the face center for E plane as well as for H plane are slightly at a different position. But over here there is a one common. All you do need to do, if you just extend this dimension, it meets at this particular point here. So this is the length, we can say, and this is the slant length here, and that is the diameter. So again, for this particular case, this curve here shows the directivity curve. So what we can see here, directivity is along this axis, and this one here shows the diameter of the horn aperture. And these are the various number of cases, that is for L equal to 75 lambda, 50 lambda, down to 0.5 lambda, that is the length of the horn antenna. Now one can actually see that for a given value of L, let's start with, let's say, 0.5 lambda. If we take this here, then as we increase the diameter, one can actually see that directivity is almost increasing linearly, and then it actually becomes a maximum here, and after that it is decreasing. The reason for the decrease is, as before, phase error has increased significantly, which results in reduction of the directivity. Now if we just take another case of, let's say, length equal to 2 lambda. Now if we keep on increasing the diameter, one can see that the directivity is increasing, but over here now this corresponds to the maximum value, and then it starts decreasing. But if you really see the corresponding maximum value, which is close to, let's say, 15.78, or let's say less than 16 dB, but had this thing gone up linearly, then instead of having this over here, this linear would have gone like this. So if you just look at the vertical line from here to corresponding to this, that would have been close to 18 dB. So that means at this particular point, we have lost directivity of close to 2 dB, which really results into the lower efficiency of the horn antenna. So let's just see corresponding to first what the textbooks say, and then we'll tell you what actually should be done. So corresponding to these maximum values, one can actually say that the gain of the conical horn is optimum when the diameter is given by this particular expression. If you recall, this particular expression is very similar to that of the pyramidal horn antenna, or you can say sectoral horn antenna, which was in H plane. So we had seen that in H plane, the variation is cosine. So for cosine variation, what we notice that the phase error can be little larger than for the uniform thing. But when we look at a circular waveguide, for a circular waveguide in this plane it is uniform, but however this value, which is maximum, that value keeps on reducing as we move towards circle. So really speaking, amplitude here is much smaller compared to the amplitude over here, and you can almost say it is relatively not uniform. And we had also seen when we discussed about the array theory, that if you take a square aperture versus circular aperture always had a lower side lobe level. So in this case also, we can actually see similar thing happens here. So this one is relatively closer to the expression which corresponds to H plane sectoral horn antenna. And if in the maximum phase deviation, if we put it, again it comes out to be 135 degree. Now my recommendation is that phase error is too high, so I do not recommend this high phase error. In fact, again in this case we can see that phase error is very high, 135 degree, and I strongly say that I don't recommend this high phase error value. I generally recommend a phase error of about 45 degree, absolute maximum can be 90 degree. Now this is the one way you can look into it. The alternate way is you can actually look at the curve given in cross book, and here again very similar to the pyramidal horn antenna, gain is shown along this axis, and over here it can be the length of the horn or the diameter of the horn. So let's say if our requirement is to design a conical horn antenna at 20 dB, so at 20 dB draw a vertical line, and correspondingly you can read the value of L lambda, which you can see is 6 here, and corresponding to this you can read the value of D lambda, which is between 4 and 5, and if you use this value you will get approximately gain of 20 dB. However, I don't recommend this thing as it is. What I suggest is you can take little larger length, which will reduce the phase error and hence improve the efficiency of the horn antenna. But however, for this larger dimension, what we can see here, these are the measured pattern of conical horn. So here this side E plane pattern is shown. You can see that E plane pattern is over here. One can see a big shoulder over here, and this is the H plane pattern. Now this pattern is slightly different compared to the previous one which we had shown for pyramidal horn antenna, in a sense that these shows the normalized value. So here you can see the normalized value is 1 and going to 0 here. So for example, if you look at the E plane pattern, and again only half side of the E plane pattern is shown, same thing will be repeated on this side. So just to save the space, it is not shown over here. Similarly, H plane pattern is given in this side, it will be on this side also, but not shown over here. So now let's just see, corresponding to this particular case here for E plane pattern, one can actually see that there is a huge shoulder over here corresponding to this value, which is about 0.37, as you can read from here, that's about -8.6 dB. And this higher side lobe level is mainly because of the larger phase error. So if we reduce the phase error, one can improve the performance, and that is why I do not recommend phase error of 135 degree. You should take phase error even less than 45 degree. In fact, I am going to show you some example where people have reported in the literature, and there they have taken a much smaller phase error, even of the order of 10 to 15 degree phase error. So that's what I want to tell you. So what we read theoretically, but practically people are not using these particular things. So we'll show you that practical example little later on, but now I'm going to show you a conical horn antenna with the difference. And what is the difference here? So what we have done, instead of using a coaxial feed like this over here, which I had given you the design detail for pyramidal horn antenna, what we had done for pyramidal horn antenna, we had put the coaxial feed like this here. Okay, so now when we were doing something like this here, so what happens if you take a coaxial feed like this here, normal, that will be the monopole antenna. So monopole antenna will radiate like this here, E plane will be this, like this, and then this one here reflects back and comes over here. So we came out with an idea that instead of using this particular concept, why not we use a microstrip antenna. So if you look at this outer dimension, that is a circular one, which you can see here also, that's a 3D view. So that is this outer one here, and then you can see this particular thing here, this is nothing but suspended circular microstrip antenna. In fact, what we have done, we have provided a support to this particular suspended this thing using a metallic post. It is suspended in the air, and we have used roughly about 1 mm thick metallic plate which is suspended, and then you can see that this is being flared. Now, I'll just tell you what it does. So, basically we know that a microstrip antenna is relatively easy to design, and whatever is the radiation pattern of the microstrip antenna, that will get enhanced. So, basically horn antenna actually enhances the gain of the microstrip antenna. And even though I am just showing you right now for a single feed, but will tell you what all the other things we can obtain, and different types of polarization can also be obtained by modifying the circular microstrip antenna. So, first let us see the results, then we will come back to this slide and see what all we can get. So, now just to show you the radiation pattern. So, for comparison, the gain of the suspended circular microstrip antenna was approximately 9 dB because it was suspended in air, hence the gain is relatively large, efficiency is very good. And then we use this circular microstrip antenna integrated with the conical horn, we got a gain of about 12.5 dB. So, you can see that the gain has been enhanced, and this is the radiation pattern which you can see over here. So, you can actually see E theta, E phi plot here, and you can see that the back radiation is fairly small, it is less than about 20 dB or so. And these are the parameters which are shown over here. One can actually see we can increase the gain. So, based on these, then we did the fabrication, and this is the measured result of integrated conical horn antenna. What you can actually see here, this is the Smith chart plot, one can get a fairly good impedance matching, and this one is the S11 plot. So, measured bandwidth for S11 less than minus 10 dB is from 2070 to 2210 megahertz. In fact, this one meets the bandwidth requirement for 3G transmission. A 3G transmission takes place from 2110 to 2170. So, you can see that this band covers the entire 3G transmit band. So, one can actually transmit very high power also, because we have used a metallic plate. In fact, one can even pump in even a kilowatt of power through this particular antenna. So, microstrip antennas, if properly designed, can give rise to a very high gain. Now, I just want to mention here, we actually have done lot of other simulation. We have just shown you one particular result, but just to mention now, for example, for circular microstrip antenna, we just use one feed, but now if we use two orthogonal feed, we can get both vertical as well as horizontal polarization. Whereas, if we use a conventional horn antenna with the monopole antenna, it is very difficult to get both the orthogonal polarization. So, one can get a single polarization, but not both the polarization. Now, again here what we also did, so that same circular microstrip antenna, what we also did, instead of feeding with 1 angle 0, 1 angle 0, which will give us 2 orthogonal polarization, we also use the feed as 1 angle 0, 1 angle 90 degree. So, that gives us circular polarization. So, we use that along with this conical horn antenna. So, again we saw that we could get circularly polarized antenna, but with the higher gain. So, depending upon the aperture which you take for horn antenna, you can realize a fairly large gain also. Then the whole concept we also extended to the pyramidal horn antenna. So, for pyramidal horn antenna, instead of taking a circular patch, what we did, we took square patch or rectangular patch. We have tried with both. So, again with, let us say, square patch or rectangular patch, if you use single feed, you will get linearly polarized horn antenna, but with a higher gain. And again there we can use two orthogonal feed, and if it is square, then you will get two orthogonal polarization with higher gain, and the isolation will depend upon whatever is the isolation of the circular patch. So, that particular application will be very useful for MIMO antenna, which is multiple input, multiple output, but it will give two orthogonal polarization. So there also, if you use a rectangular way microstrip antenna of different dimension, let us say L and W, then these L and W can be resonant at two different frequencies if we again use two orthogonal feed. Again, the same horn antenna can be used to enhance the gain of the antenna. So this particular thing I just want to mention. So from a point I did not know how to feed the horn antenna, okay, and then we had to do a lot of study. We studied the parametric study, looked into the things, we did the fabrication, and later on we actually went on to invent a new type of antenna itself. So we actually reported this particular antenna for first time, and we have even published paper where we have used microstrip antenna integrated with horn antenna. In fact, I feel that the next research will be where you combine concepts of different antenna and put into different configurations. So for example, we combine microstrip antenna with, let us say, horn antenna. Similarly, you can do lot of other combinations to design, you can say, different type of antennas, or you can design absolutely new type of antennas, or you can even design exotic antennas and so on. And that is the reason I have been saying many a times, I have said that antenna design is not just science, it is also about art. And why I say art? How you fit the whole thing in a given space available to you, or for a different application where you need to put it. So now we notice that this horn antennas have a real problem, and that real problem is that the E plane and H plane radiation pattern are not symmetrical. We notice that E plane and H plane patterns are not very good. One can see over here that we have a basically major problem in the E plane because of the high shoulder, and because of the higher shoulder, what happens? Lot of power gets radiated in this particular direction, whereas H plane is relatively better. So then lot of research has been done and lot of papers are there where people try to reduce this shoulder. So let us just look at a few techniques today, and then we will also continue in the next lecture. So we will start with the one of the technique where what it is known as a dual mode pyramidal horn antenna. Now what this really is, now recall pyramidal horn antenna, we had seen that we operate that horn antenna for T10 mode, and for T10 mode we had seen the field distribution, which is maximum at the center, and as we go to the edge field becomes 0 over here. So field is 0. It goes to maxima, it goes to 0 here. And since the variation along this plane is sinusoidal, that gives us a lower side lobe performance. But since the field is uniform along this axis, so that gives us a poor side lobe performance, and also this problem gets more because of the larger phase error also. So then the combination has been done, instead of exciting just 10 mode, which is coming over here, a step has been used over here so that this particular dimension now supports the 1-2 mode. What is 1-2 mode? That means field variation 1 means 1 half wavelength variation, right? That means half wavelength variation is this. But what 2 means? That means 2 times lambda by 2 variation along this. So one can actually see that if you will just put over here, you can see the direction here. So if I just say that this is minus, then 0 plus 0 minus. So that is the one wavelength variation, or you can say 2 times lambda by 2 variation. So if we now excite this mode as well as this mode, and that mode is getting excited because of the change in the dimensions over here which supports this particular mode. So now when the wave which is launched over here, which is basically predominantly this, and from here this mode gets excited which gets superimposed on this. So now one can see if we add these two things, what one can see here, this field is going in this direction, and this one here is, let us say, if I say all plus 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 maximum, and here it is minus maxima. So plus maxima, minus maxima, will give rise to close to 0. As we move along here, this minus is becoming 0 and then it becomes, let us say, plus. Now, this is same as this here. So, field will get added up here and it will gradually added up. Maximum field will be here, it will reduce to this value here. Similarly, the same thing is happening here. Field is close to negative value here, negative maxima. This is, let us say, positive. So, one can actually see that this is the T10 mode, which is uniform along this here, and this higher order mode, which is 1-2 mode, that 2 means 2 half wavelength variation along this direction. So, one can see that this is in the opposite direction of this. So, field gets cancelled. So, we get a 0 here and then fields getting added up. So, we get maximum field which goes to 0, maximum field which goes to 0. And again, similarly, we already know that in this direction, field variation was anyway sinusoidal. So, if you look into this particular case here, so this multimode pyramidal horn antenna basically will have a symmetrical radiation pattern. And this kind of a symmetrical radiation pattern is required. Just imagine that we have a parabolic dish antenna and this horn antenna is being used as a feed. Now, if the field is not symmetrical in both the plane, then what will happen? It will give rise to a asymmetry in the radiation pattern also. And these larger side lobe levels are very undesired when we are trying to feed parabolic dish antenna. So, that is why we need antenna which actually has a symmetrical pattern, because it is going to feed a symmetrical configuration with low side lobe level. So, in fact, there are two main applications which I mentioned in the earlier lecture, that horn antennas are known as standard gain horn antenna. So, we do not want also there that the radiation pattern should be relatively changing. Second thing is that it is used as a feed for reflector antenna, and most of the time we would like to have a symmetrical configuration, and hence these corrections are required so that we get a symmetrical radiation pattern. So, we just looked into the pyramidal horn antenna. Similar concept has been also applied to the conical horn antenna also. So, what you can see here that it starts with the circular waveguide, and then another diameter circular waveguide is added to that, and then flaring is done. So, basically this circular waveguide supports, let us say, the fundamental mode, then this particular circular waveguide supports another mode here, and if you look at again the field distribution, see it is uniform over here and it is going to 0 over here, but even vertically it is uniform and then it is relatively becoming small. But now on this here, if we superimpose, which is you can see here, this is in the opposite direction. And then we have a 0 in the same direction going there. So, if you take the superposition of the two, so this one is in the opposite direction, so we get field equal to 0 here. So, if you look at this particular thing, this dual mode horn antenna has a symmetrical field distribution, and if the field distribution is symmetrical, radiation pattern will be also symmetrical. Now, instead of using a stepped, we can actually use also the tapered configuration also. In fact, I just want to show you that and then I will come back over here. So, instead of that, instead of using a step over here, one can actually use a stepless or tapered distribution here. So, what actually happens, if we take a step, then let us say the step will be somewhere here. Okay. Now, normally what is done, let us say if the step is here, so, just imagine this dimension like this here. What is done? You take the center point of that and draw the line like this here. So, basically if you see this particular area, which is this part has been removed and this part has been added. Now, performance wise this is very similar to the previous case. Then you might wonder, then why should I use the second case over this one here? In fact, when we were working on a very high power application, so we found out that when you are looking for a very high power application, because of this step discontinuity at this particular point, heating loss was much more, because what happens, think about, let us say, the water flow. Okay, suppose if you are injecting the water, let us say water is coming and then there is a change in the diameter, what will happen? Water flow will be like this here. Towards the end, the water flow will be relatively less. Or you think about that you are sending the water from the larger diameter to the smaller diameter. So what will happen? When you have a larger diameter at this portion, water will try to reflect back. But instead of that, if you use the taper thing, then what will happen? Water will relatively smoothly go over here. So you can apply the concept of the water flow in the microwave also. So basically now you can say current flow or power flow, there will be less turbulence. In fact, we did the simulation for the stepped one as well as the tapered one, and we found out that the power losses were relatively much lesser for the smooth transition one. So for the application where you are actually going to transmit very high power, and just to give you some example, there are some radars that transmit megawatt of power also, even though some of them are pulse, but even let us say pulse power of 1 megawatt with a duty cycle of say 10% still means 100 kilowatt average power. So it really means lot of power may get lost at the interface, and that may cause lot of heating at that particular joint, then you have to provide cooling of that particular section. So it is better sometimes to use this taper section. Or there is another thing you can use, and this is known as a corrugated horn antenna. In fact, this is one of the practical example I will show you, and you can just look at the figure. I will show you this thing in more detail, but I want you to just have this figure here. See, in this figure, if you see, we have lot of corrugations have been added over here. In fact, I also call these things as a crocodile. If you look at the crocodile, crocodile mouth looks like this here, and these are also known as the teeth. Okay, so that's like a crocodile teeth here. But what I want you to look into this here, see what is the diameter over here, that's about 3.5 lambda, and what is the total length, 6.4 lambda, 4.5 lambda, and then there is an additional one here. Even if you just add over here, that's about 10.9 lambda. So if you just use this dimension as this dimension, try to calculate what is the phase error, and you will see that the phase error of this is way before or much less than 135 degree phase error. So you can see that people, when they design practical things, they don't use that kind of a high phase error. So I'll continue from here in the next lecture, and we will look into more things about corrugated horn antenna, how the teeth dimension should be chosen, what should be the depth of the teeth, what should be the diameter, what should be the thickness of the teeth, what should be the gap between the teeth, and so on. And we'll also look at how to design very broadband horn antenna. To summarize, so today we talked about conical horn antenna, and then we also talked about microstrip antenna feed to the conical horn antenna, and I did mention to you about that instead of conical horn, one can also use pyramidal horn antenna along with rectangular microstrip antenna to get orthogonal polarization or circular polarization. So all the advantages of microstrip antennas can be obtained by using this horn antenna, and the advantages of horn antenna would be it will increase the gain of the antenna without having any additional power divider network. So with that, we'll conclude today's lecture, and we'll see you next time about more things on horn antenna. Till then, bye.